Hi everyone, welcome back to the episode of Ask Dr. Nick. My name is Dr. Nick Schmidlkoffer and I work for the Neurologic Wellness Institute. And today's question is going to be related to COVID-19. It is, what causes post-COVID fatigue? And so fatigue is one of the main symptoms either during COVID or after getting SARS-CoV-2, having the disease of COVID. And it's kind of part of one of those long hauler symptoms. And so I wanted to discuss a paper with a very interesting theory on it that I think is very plausible, and then I'll kind of discuss why that theory makes sense and a little bit more anatomy and show some pictures with that as well. I first want to emphasize that there is no definite answer to what causes post-COVID fatigue. It could just be a lack of endurance. It could be due to still problems with breathing, but it could be due to problems in the brain. And so we know that the SARS-CoV-2 virus comes in through our nose, through some air particles, nose or mouth, and can affect our lungs. But there are also these neurological manifestations. And so I want to discuss one of the neurological manifestations that are very common with chronic fatigue syndrome, and therefore may also be affecting people with post-COVID syndrome. So we will get right into the paper. We are over a year now into the COVID-19 pandemic, and so I think this is just a good time to start talking about some of this stuff. So this paper is from 2021. COVID-19 and chronic fatigue syndrome is the worst yet to come. On the abstract, he just wants to talk about this long-term sequela of myalgic encephalomyelitis, basically muscle pain and possibly brain and spinal cord inflammation and chronic fatigue syndrome in COVID-19 patients. He says in this paper how he integrates the insights pertaining to the lymphatic system. So I'm going to show you a picture here on the lymphatic system in a sec, and the nasal cerebrospinal fluid. And so I'll show you the cerebrospinal fluid as well. And so his hypothesis here is Peter Wostrand, Department of Psychiatry, right, in Belgium. His hypothesis is that this syndrome may result from damage to olfactory sensory neurons, or the nerves that are bringing in our smell, causing reduced outflow of the cerebrospinal fluid through the cribriform plate right up here in our nose, and this further leading to congestion of the lymphatic system with subsequent toxic buildup within the central nervous system. This causes a lack of cerebrospinal fluid to be drained, and therefore can cause increased pressure in the brain, leading to the symptoms of chronic fatigue. And so he says, if confirmed, the lymphatic system could represent a target in combating post-COVID-19 fatigue syndrome. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about these other aspects here. So we can look at this picture. So this is a picture of someone's face, okay, the skull. And so it's cut off kind of right in the middle on the side. And so right here we have the brain and we have our nasal cavity, and here we have the olfactory nerves. Okay, the olfactory nerves are cranial nerve 1. They come in from the olfactory epithelium or the nasal cavity, and then they bring in that sensation of smell through this cribriform plate. So this is a bone that brings it up through right into the brain, into this olfactory bulb, where there is a connection, and that connection then goes back into other parts of the brain. Okay, and so the theory is that this area gets really inflamed. That's what causes the lack of smell and then eventually taste in patients, because there's inflammation in this epithelium, inflammation in these nerves. Okay, so then we look at this picture, and this picture shows a little more close up. So again, you don't see all the nerves coming off, but here's that olfactory epithelium. Here's the cribriform plate. And so if we look over here, the cribriform plate is part of our skull bone. Okay? And it has these tiny little holes in it where the olfactory nerves go through and then connect into the olfactory epithelium. When odors come in, they bind, and that binding causes a specific reaction, sends a signal, and tells us what we're smelling. Okay, with COVID-19 and the virus, if it affects and infects our epithelium here, it causes inflammation. And that inflammation can cause swelling of these nerves, swelling of this area, leading to these little holes to maybe get clogged. And that is what he is describing as letting go, or not allowing the cerebrospinal fluid from the brain to go through. Okay, so if we look at this picture, then on the right we have our brain, and that brain kind of sits in this gel-like structure, okay, or fluid-filled structure, and so that's the light blue, and the light blue is this cerebrospinal fluid, or fluid that surrounds the cerebrum, the brain, and the spinal cord. And so it's made in these little choroid plexus here, and then it's distributed into or throughout the middle of the brain, the center of the brain, and then it exits, and it also goes around the entire brain. So it's kind of sitting in this structure. Well, this needs to get recycled. And so it recycles through the venous system, or our veins. And so the dark blue is the veins, and that's how it can recycle and then go out into our typical cardiovascular system circulation. But more recently, just in the last 10 years, we've had more evidence of this lymphatic system. Basically, the lymphatic system is it's lymphatic, like lymph node. It is what all our lymph nodes attach to. And so when we have infections or viruses or bacteria in our interstitial fluid, basically within our skin, like between our skin and muscle, that fluid is going to get tracked into our lymphatic system, go into our lymph nodes, and therefore we can identify, oh, hey, there's a virus bacteria in this area. Until recently, like 10 years, we didn't really know that there was a lymphatic system in the brain. But there is. It's called the glymphatic system, with a G. The GL is glial, and these glial cells, like these green cells over here on the left, these glial cells are going to wrap and protect the brain. It kind of separates the brain from the blood, so it's a blood-brain barrier. And these glial cells, there's actually more glial cells than these like little purple ones that are the neurons, those are the ones that are actually giving a signal or an impulse. The glial cells are protecting the brain, but they are also allowing these little glymphatic vessels to enter and or to leave the brain. So this is another way that cerebrospinal fluid can be released. And we know that cerebrospinal fluid can be released through that cribriform plate, okay, into the nasal cavity, which then goes into our mouth, swallowed, or maybe we need to blow our nose, something like that. Or into the lymphatic system that are going to obviously be there in our face, in our cervical spine or neck as well. Okay, so that's the major theory, is that the olfactory nerves get inflamed. There is a lack of separation, or there's a lack of release of the cerebrospinal fluid through this area, which just causes a slight backup into the dural venous sinuses, into the venous system, and that causes a pressure build in the head. This pressure might not be able to be recognized with a lumbar puncture, might not be able to be recognized when looking in the eye to look for changes in pressure, like a papilledema, the back of the eye swelling. It may not be recognized in an MRI. But this slight increase in pressure puts a little bit more stress on the neurons, and that leads to brain fog or fatigue, difficulty being able to think or use cognition. And this is just a very good example, a very good possibility of what causes that post-COVID chronic fatigue syndrome. And so if we go back to the paper here, we'll just look at a couple pieces here. And so he talks about in here that there's evidence here that chronic fatigue syndrome patients not having COVID can have a variant of the intracranial hypertension, okay? And so, or IIH, or idiopathic intracranial hypertension. And so that is just more pressure in the brain, more swelling. He also mentions that right here, improvements noted following CSF drainage in chronic fatigue patients at least suggest a neurological basis of their symptoms, right? Of their symptoms of headache or chronic fatigue. Same thing here. There's supportive evidence that idiopathic intracranial hypertension and possibly majority of chronic fatigue syndrome is associated with congestion of the glymphatic system. So he is just describing, there's a lot of evidence in the research that could lead to this hypothesis, and I think this is a good one. Sorry, I wanted to show one more thing. And so he says that one way that we could maybe fix that, we could maybe improve symptoms, is through a couple different techniques. So if this is true, if the lymphatic system, there's a lack of drainage, besides decreasing inflammation in the nose through proper diet, nutrition, maybe some red laser, there we could do like osteopathic manipulation or chiropractic manipulation like we do in our office. It's very similar, but it is a practical option for improving lymphatic drainage. And then he talks about this Perrin technique as well, which is another manual diagnosis and treatment technique to help improve lymphatic drainage. So I just wanted to show that there are plenty of possibilities that COVID could be causing chronic fatigue or chronic fatigue syndrome in you or a loved one. And this is just one hypothesis, and I think it's a pretty good one. We have had a couple patients with this. They have responded well, and so it is a possibility. So if you have any questions or comments, please leave them below. If you have any suggestions for future topics, I would love to hear them. Thanks again, and have a great day. Stay healthy.